Introduction. Wild as Women, written and narrated by P.D. Watts. A parliamentary system that hands the keys to the nation's future to a collection of cynical bigots and their so-called parties. Parties which, by their very structure, encourage these people to indulge in juvenile, confrontational games and farcical posturing at the taxpayers' expense, to say nothing of holding sway over our lives, ought not to exist, never mind prevail. The power to change this, however, is vested in this confrontational farce and those same groups of individuals. And yet their conduct is rarely questioned by us, or effectively challenged by a supposedly free press, which continues to collectively demonstrate its unwillingness to emphasize our concerns by demonstrating an unwavering desire to maintain the status quo. The ballot box can thus measure nothing but our impotence, leaving successive generations of the British people powerless to intervene. Wild as Women is therefore a necessarily fictional account of how Mike Carlow, a millionaire many times over, is coerced by his business partner, Geoff Mason, into setting out to harness the shameful pursuit of self-interest at Westminster, and by exploiting the predictability of our news media, make a desperate bid to rid the United Kingdom of political wastrels and an archaic system of government that has succeeded in bringing a once confident and independent group of nations to its knees. Prologue. Gordon Templeton couldn't remember the last time he'd been at the wheel of his car this early in the morning. His brother Andrew had lived, he now reminded himself, in what had originally been the family home, the house they'd shared all too briefly with their parents, before being sent away to school. He'd gone up to Cambridge after his time at Eton. While apparently hell-bent on self-destruction, Andrew had dropped out, to use the in-phrase of the time, a period which had begun as a gap year and continued unbroken for the rest of his life. The passing of their parents had financed his debauchery for a time, giving him the house along with investments and savings, yielding more than enough income to support him, had his addiction to alcohol and drugs not intervened. Of course, fathering a child out of wedlock and surrendering a fortune to a predictably sluttish ex-wife hadn't helped. Had his brother really taken his own miserable life? Templeton supposed he must have, if that was what the police were now saying. He turned into the driveway, the sound of tyres on gravel stirring memories of childhood, as he circled the forecourt and brought the car to a halt opposite the open front door. It was the first time he'd been back there in years. A uniformed constable intercepted him. He introduced himself, explaining that he was there at the behest of Chief Superintendent Keane. Keane came out to meet him. "My condolences, Sir Gordon," he said, stifling a yawn. "Thank you for coming." Templeton noticed the policeman studying him minutely. "Not a pretty sight, sir. Best not to go in," Keane added quietly. He continued to study him. "Your brother shot himself with a Purdy, Sir Gordon. One of a quite handsome pair, perhaps, I should add. He left a note saying he couldn't meet his financial obligations." Templeton frowned. "I see." "Yes," Keane added, "but what would you say the property's worth, sir? I am right in thinking it did belong to him." "Indeed you are, Superintendent. But it'll be mortgaged to the hilt, whatever its value. He had, how shall I put it, several habits to support." Keane considered what he said. "Habits, you say?" "An alcoholic, addicted to heaven knows what else, and cursed with an insatiable appetite for the wrong kind of woman. Need I say more? I washed my hands of him a long time ago. Thank God our parents didn't live to see this. I was thinking on the way over. The world will be a better place."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.